Assalamu alaikum. One of the ideas that I wanted to develop in my little book, The Young Muslim's Guide to Modern Science, is not just the typical branches of science, such as geology or biology, astronomy, cosmology, physics, chemistry. I wanted also to address some of the topics of today that are definitely related to science, but are some of the applications of science and some of the troublesome, sometimes we may say, prospects of science and technology, such as what? Such as genetic engineering, such as environmental changes, climate change, such as the digital revolution and artificial intelligence, such as the search for aliens, the search for life elsewhere on other planets. All of these topics, I devoted a chapter in my book to addressing some of these ideas. Generally, how are things happening today? So we understand what science is saying, what technology is doing, but we want to also understand what is the Islamic perspective on all of this. And indeed, there are a number of Islamic works today, people trying to address these topics, some of them very sophisticated and very advanced. We have a whole literature on Islamic bioethics. Is cloning allowed? On what basis? Why is cloning not allowed? Is cloning for other animals allowed? Cloning for humans? Cloning of other species? Genetic engineering? Genetic engineering of what? Of plants? Of animals? Which animals? Of humans? On what scale? What do we mean by genetic engineering? Modifying genes? Which genes? Some people say bad genes that give us some really troublesome diseases. Is this the definition of bad genes? Are we allowed to modify these bad genes in humans in order to rectify these diseases? But if we modify these bad genes, isn't there any secondary effect to this? Are genes only bad in general or good in general, or do they work on other things? If we modify these genes, aren't we going to modify some other things? But some other fields or some other topics are not as well developed in the Islamic literature of today. I will mention in a moment that there has been recently some effort done on climate change, for example, from the Islamic perspective, or Islamic environmentalism. But for example, there are some new topics which are really producing anxiety in many people, thinkers, scientists, technologists, such as artificial intelligence. And there we find very little work being done. So I try to mention in my book some of the efforts and some of the ideas, some of the Islamic principles, what is happening here and there. I want to mention maybe just quickly a couple of examples on this. One of the most important developments of recent years is the genetic modification technique called CRISPR. This technique of CRISPR is an easy, powerful, cheap method of intervening on the genome, on the DNA, and modifying some pieces very easily and very quickly. This is genetic engineering made very quick and very easy, and this is going to give so much power to scientists and researchers around the world in many labs to do all kinds of modifications. And indeed, last December 2018, one Chinese scientist did an experiment which the whole world reacted to by taking some embryos, human embryos, and making some genetic intervention using CRISPR to try to modify some genes, because he said the father had been a patient stricken with the HIV disease of AIDS, and he feared that this gene in the embryo, the baby daughters who were going to be born later, would have this capacity to be affected by HIV. So he said, I wanted to modify this gene so as to make them more resistant in the future to this HIV virus. Now, everybody reacted because this was a very dangerous precedent. That how do you know that you're going to be successful? And indeed, he himself admitted that it wasn't perfectly successful, that some other genes had been affected, that this gene was not rectified properly, etc., etc. So this kind of experiment is going to be so easy to do, even though most countries, more than 50 countries in the world, make this unlawful, prohibited, and yet As you see, there are a number of scientists who feel that they should do it because they are convinced that this is a good thing to do, and we're going to be confronted with many such cases. So there, as I explained in the book, there are some Islamic principles of what should be modified, what should not be modified, what are the goals to do, what is the preservation principle to act, what is the precautionary principle to be applied in one case or another, and we have to be careful. The other example I want to mention is climate change. In July or August 2015, there was a big congress in Istanbul that addressed climate change and other environmental issues, such as deforestation, such as the pollution of the air around us, the difficulty that millions of people now have in breathing. You can see many images in many, many cities that have become unlivable, unbreathable. In any case, these dozens of Muslim thinkers, religious scholars, scientists, policymakers, etc., assembled in this Congress in Istanbul and issued what was called the Istanbul Declaration. This Istanbul Declaration reviewed the Islamic principles, such as, for example, we know that the Prophet, peace be upon him, alayhi salatu wasalam, had implemented a way of life that we today should be implemented, such as, for example, we know that he tried to preserve water as much as possible, and he instructed his companions when they make ablution, wudu, to try to use the least amount of water possible. One, that he ate as simply and as little as possible throughout his life, that he never overindulged in food and consumption. So little consumption or rational consumption was a one way of life of the Prophet himself. Three, that he forbade his companions of killing animals for sport, just for fun. He said, we kill animals only in the name of God and only because we need that when we need them to eat. Other than this, we should never touch the animals. In fact, even when we need to eat and we kill them, we need to kill them with the utmost mercy, rahmah, and we try to preserve them from any pain and from any even psychological pain to others. We never kill them in front of other animals. And a number of such principles, the hima, for example, these places in the environment or around the village that was preserved, that people would use for plantation or for animals, etc., sort of protected zones or protected regions. In any case, all of these Islamic principles that we find in the Quran or in the Sirah, in the biography of the Prophet himself, were applied in this Istanbul Declaration to come out with some guidelines and some goals. For example, that the Muslim scholars in Istanbul called for the complete stoppage of production of greenhouse gases, CO2, CH4, etc., by the year 2050, one, and two, a complete transformation and turning from fossil fuels to renewable energy also by the year 2050. These are very, very ambitious goals. I don't think any country will be able to reach these goals by the year even 2100, but by establishing these ambitious goals and by setting them on Islamic principles, it was an extraordinary idea. I want to also mention very briefly artificial intelligence, which is going to be a prime topic in the years to come. Why is artificial intelligence a problem that we need to worry about? First of all, because we are developing machines that are autonomous, first of all. Artificial intelligence means the machine, the computer or the robot will be able to make decisions by itself, will be able to judge the situation and act. That is autonomy. This autonomy could make it decide to start killing, for example, if it is equipped with weapons. Even if we program it to always abide by the principle of never hurting anybody, etc. But in some cases, it will be difficult to find a compromise. So this autonomy of the machine is a problem that we need to be careful about. There may be some errors or some unanticipated flaws in the artificial intelligence, in the algorithm, in the program, in the robot. There may be some errors, and that will lead to some big problems if these machines are autonomous, very capable, intelligent, perhaps even super intelligent. Now we're going to have some computers that can do a lot more than even our brains can do. There's a lot of information that they will carry. This information that they will carry about us, about the world. So this is personal information. This is private information. This is information about the state. This is information about the society. And they may exchange it. They may develop it in certain ways. So this is an issue to be worried about. Something called transhumanism, which is when we start improving or enhancing our own mental capabilities, such as putting some chips into our brains, making our bodies more powerful, adding some steel or some artificial muscles to our bodies. This is transhumanism. Humans going the extra step, becoming more powerful mentally, in terms of intelligence, in terms of muscular power, etc., etc. So all of this is showing us that there are some dangers over the horizon because of all these developments, technological developments, whether in the environment or in our biologies, with the genes, the genetic engineering, or with the digital revolution, artificial intelligence, robots, etc. I have developed all of this in a very simple and clear with examples and Islamic principles in my book. I invite you to read over this chapter and the rest of the book. Thank you for your attention. Assalamu alaikum.